If it was your job to give this tree species a name, what name would you give it? Would you choose something that had special meaning just to you or to your tribe? Or do you think a name with more universal appeal would be better? This is essentially the problem that modern taxonomy attempts to solve using systematics. So taxonomy is the science of naming organisms. And systematics arranges them in a way so that relationships among organisms are made clear. Another name for this is known as phylogenetic analysis. Biologists use a system developed by an 18th century Swedish botanist named Carl Linnaeus. And Linnaeus came up with a binomial naming system that could be adopted universally, regardless of the local language. So for example, this tree species in English is known as black locust, but to the native tribes like the Miami or the Shawnee, they might each have their own name. So by proposing a standardized naming system, it would facilitate communication and more collaborative science. The Linnaean system uses a two-part name that is Latinized. Species are identified by their genus and a specific epithet. The genus name is always capitalized, and the specific epithet almost always in lowercase. And both parts of the binomial name, when appearing in print, are either underlined or italicized to indicate that it's in its Latin form. A taxonomist is a researcher that fully describes and names a new species. A taxon is a formal name for a group of organisms that can occur at any level of the Linnaean taxonomic hierarchy. For example, species is the most exclusive and specific group. Modern humans belong to the species named Homo sapiens. These taxonomic groups become broader and more inclusive the further up the hierarchy that we go. Modern taxonomy uses the Linnaean naming system to reconstruct the evolutionary history of a group, what's known as its phylogeny. And a good phylogeny can then be used to make predictions about what kinds of traits should appear in known species, or even what new species remain to be discovered. Traits like a version of hemoglobin that can deliver oxygen under low pH conditions, or immune system molecules that might interfere with viral transmission. A major advantage of modern systematics and taxonomy is that species are described and classified based on traits inherent to the organism itself, and not something projected by human observers. Another advantage of modern systematics is that we can more fully comprehend the diversity of life on our planet and truly understand how organisms are related to each other. We use figures known as cladograms to hypothesize relationships. This is a cladogram that represents life at the broadest taxonomic level, the domain. Three domains of life are currently recognized: bacteria, archaea, and eukarya. The challenge to taxonomists who spend years studying their organism in order to properly classify them is to focus on the right kinds of traits, homologous traits that are derived due to common ancestry are what's needed. And this is something Linnaeus recognized, even if he didn't fully understand all the evolutionary processes that produce those traits. A homologous trait can exist below the level of the organism on the biological hierarchy, that is, at the level of molecules like DNA, at the cellular or tissue level, or the organ level. For example, if you just observed how forelimbs of different mammals were used, they might not appear related, but the underlying bone architecture is homologous, as all these animals have the same long bones in their forelimbs of a humerus, a radius, and an ulna. The relative sizes of the bones are different depending on how the animal uses its forelimb. But the bones themselves are conserved and exist due to the distant ancestors of all these mammals. Nature conserves many traits. New traits are not necessarily reinvented, but more often they are built and modified from pre-existing traits. For example, the forelimb of a bat is used for flying and for climbing, whereas the ancestor to the bat used its forelimb for climbing only. Traits can also be homoplasias. These are traits that may appear the same or may even function the same, but they do not exist because of any ancestral relationship between the organisms. Homoplasia traits are traits that arose due to convergence. If your only interest was grouping all flying animals together, then a trait like wing would be useful, but it's not useful for any biological classification. So a trait like wing is a homoplasia trait. The leaves of a fern and the leaves of a locust tree both function to capture sunlight for the plant and may even resemble each other, but their similarities in shape and function arise from the necessities of life in a forest, not because there's a close relationship between the species. These species are separated by over 300 million years of evolution. All plants use cellulose to build cell walls, have chloroplasts inside their cells for photosynthesis, and use the same biochemistry for harvesting sunlight. Not surprisingly, photosynthesis is a homologous trait that is highly conserved across organisms that photosynthesize, including cyanobacteria, algae, and plants. So biologists must watch out for homoplasia traits, because even the experts can be fooled by all the clever ways that traits have evolved in their particular environment. A homoplasia trait is not a good trait under modern classification schemes. When traits are conserved so reliably across evolutionary time that they are retained in all descendants, these are traits that we can use for higher taxonomic groupings, such as at the phylum level, class, order, and family. These shared ancestral traits are known as plesiomorphies. Mammary glands, like what you see in this lactating doe, are a good example of a plesiomorphic trait for a class of animals known as mammals. But the fact that deer, raccoons, and humans all have mammary glands requires us to use other more recently derived traits for distinguishing among these three species. Groups that share derived traits from a common ancestor form clades. With a good cladogram, we could quickly visualize degrees of relatedness between molecules sampled from different individuals, relatedness between species, or relatedness between any level of the taxonomic hierarchy. In modern classifications, the objective is to sort nature's diversity into monophyletic groups. This means that all descendants have a single common ancestor. In this figure, the domestic dog and the gray wolf form a monophyletic clade with a recent ancestor in common, indicated by this branching point, whereas both species are only distantly related to jackals and African wild dogs. Oftentimes, there are competing hypotheses, and so science uses the principle of parsimony to decide between two competing ideas. A parsimonious explanation is one that makes the fewest number of assumptions to explain the data. In this example, we see two cladograms, and thus have two hypotheses to explain the relationship between seven groups of animals. And you could make a strong argument for classifying dolphins with bony fishes, as they live, feed, and move in very similar ways. But dolphins also share some very complex traits with terrestrial mammals, including mammary glands, four-chambered hearts, and the presence of fur. Thus, instead of being homologous traits, we would have to interpret them as homoplasia traits. And without good evidence for this much more complicated explanation, we use parsimony as our principle to decide.